Item 14.1 on our agenda. This is a Brinkworthy Park dedication decision around the subdivision. Our planner, Caitlin Brownrigg, is going to be introducing the report. And is the applicant's representative present?
No.
Okay, good. So we'll turn it over to you, and then we'll go to questions of clarification from the trustees and then into our decision making.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yes, I received an email from the applicant's agent saying that the applicant supported the recommendations in the staff report, and so they would not attend. So this concerns subdivision application 2011.9, the strata conversion of the Brinkworthy Mobile Home Park. And this proposal is to donate cash in lieu of parkland to the Parks and Recreation Commission to satisfy requirements in the Local Government Act and the official community plan. So the local section 941 of the Local Government Act requires that the owner of land being subdivided must provide parkland or cash in lieu of parkland equal to 5% of the value of the land if more than 3 lots of less than 2 hectares are being created. And the official community plan states that the local trust committee will require park dedication land or amount of money that is equal to 5% of the land being subdivided. So this subdivision application would convert the Brinkworthy Mobile Home Park to a bare land strata subdivision of 137 lots. The subdivision application was made in September of 2011, but it's part of a longer process, including rezoning. So the owner actually requested that they provide cash in lieu of parkland. And based on an appraisal that was submitted to the Parks and Recreation Commission and a calculation done by the Parks, I'm going to get his title wrong, the Parks and Recreation Park Manager, yep, Mr. Rurs, the cash in lieu amount relative to the land value would be $80,000. So staff recommendation is that the Island Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee accept the amount of $80,000 as cash in lieu of parkland to satisfy the parkland dedication conditions of subdivision application SSSUB 2011.9, subject to receipt of monies by the Capital Regional District within 12 months of this resolution.
Thank you. Questions from the trustees?
A comment more than a question. 80,000 seems fair today, but 80,000 will be, it'll melt fairly quickly. It'll be expended. Parkland is a resource that the community would enjoy in perpetuity. So if there is a possibility of obtaining land by and large instead of a cash settlement instead, I think it's in the community interest always to settle for the land. Now, I think in terms of Brinkworthy, it's a small community. It's been there for a long time. Accepting the recommendation is something I'm prepared to do this time. But I think as a general policy, it's probably one that I would want to avoid as a trustee.
I agree wholeheartedly. I assume there just isn't the land available. There is no land that could be dedicated as parkland. And the little I know, I've driven around Brinkworthy, I don't think there is anything there.
Shall I respond?
Yes, please.
Part of the rezoning application was also the dedication of the agricultural land reserve land to the fire hall. Mm-hmm. So it's my understanding that the remaining land, as you say, is all developed.
Right, so that we don't have an option in this case. Mm-hmm. Fine.
It may be something for the trustees to look at wording in your official community plan, which does give guidance. Some trust committees have signaled in their visionary document that they are always going to have a bias towards land, not cash.
Yeah.
So that might be something to have a look at.
Yeah.
Well, okay.
But I hear what you're talking about in this in this situation. Mm-hmm.
I'm happy to move the recommendation that the Salt Spring Local Trust Committee accept the amount of $80,000 as cash in lieu of parkland to satisfy the parkland dedication conditions of subdivision application SSSUB 2011 spot 9, Richard Cook, 135 Brinkworthy Road, subject to receipt of monies by Capital Regional District within 12 months of this resolution.
And I second that.
Moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Are you ready to vote? All those in favour? That passes unanimously. Thank you very much to the planner. If we can move to item 14.2, which is page 73 of the agenda, and this is the liquor licence referral from the Liquor Control Board regarding Moby's Pub at Salt Spring Marina. And we'll invite the planner to introduce her report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So this follows up on the previous agenda item from the March 15th meeting, seeking LTC direction to consult the public on this application. And now we get to the meat of the application, which is to increase the liquor primary license for Moby's Pub. So this application will increase the liquor primary license and cancel the food primary license for Moby's Pub, which essentially will be a return to the license configuration in 2009. And the seats from the food primary license will be transferred to the liquor primary license. It won't increase the seating of Moby's Pub. The result will be that minors will no longer be allowed in the pub. Now, notice was placed in the March 21st and March 28th issues of the Driftwood newspaper, and it was also sent to the Salt Spring Island detachment of the RCMP. And as we haven't received the notice, invited concerned members of the community to either contact the planner, me, or to contact the applicant, Robert Steinbeck, with questions and comments, or to come to this meeting to provide feedback. So no comments have been received, either from the public or a response from the RCMP. The Liquor Control and Licensing Board, which is the referral agency, which is the agency that referred it to us, asks local government input on the potential to increase noise and other impacts on the community. And as this application will reconcile the existing operation of Moby's Pub functioning as a liquor primary establishment with the liquor license, it won't result in a change of operations that will either increase noise or other impacts to the community, aside from the impact of not allowing minors in the pub anymore. So the recommendations, and these recommendations are developed, were developed using a template provided by the Liquor Control and Licensing Branch. So they're sort of dealing with specific requirements from that that agency. And so the staff recommendation is that in view of receiving no public comments concerning this application, the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee recommends amendment of the license for the following reasons. The increase in the occupant load of the liquor primary license is in accordance with Salt Spring Island Land Use Bylaw number 355 and is not expected to increase noise or other impacts on the community, as discussed in the March 28, 2012 staff report. And the second recommendation is that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee advises the Liquor Control and Licensing Branch that it sought to gather the views of residents on application SSLCB 2012.1 by posting notice in the Driftwood newspaper for 2 weeks prior to the meeting date. Residents had an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant and provide comments to the planner assigned to the file.
Thank you. Is the applicant present?
I am.
Would you like to add anything to the planner's report or let the trustees know anything?
I really think it's all been said. I think it's very straightforward. I have nothing further to add. We had a discussion about this at the last meeting 3 weeks ago. I'm happy to answer any questions that may have come up in the interim period, but I have nothing further to add.
Great, thanks. Thank you. Any questions from the trustees for the applicant?
No, we discussed this at our last meeting. I have no problems with this, and I'm happy to make a motion.
Any questions of the planner?
No, I mean, Robert Steinbeck is the president of the Chamber of Commerce. He runs a tight organization, and he manages his premises very well. I don't think any undesirable social consequences will come as a result of this. I'm fully behind it.
Great. Would you like to put a resolution on the floor?
Certainly. Do we require the first and second part?
Apparently, yes.
Yes, if I may respond to that. Yes, the Liquor Control and Licensing Branch asks for a resolution from the local government, and they need both of these resolutions in order to move forward.
Okay, well, that, in view of receiving no public comments concerning this application, the Salt Spring Local Trust Committee recommends amendment of the license for the following reasons. The increase in the occupant load of the liquor primary license is in accordance with the Salt Spring Island Land Use Bylaw number 355 and is not expected to increase noise or other impacts on the community as discussed in the March 28, 2012 staff report, in brackets Robert Steinbeck, SSLCB 2012.1, 124 Upper Ganges Road. And that.
Let's just pause that.
You want to pause there, okay.
Do you have some advice for us?
Oh,
do you want to run it all into one resolution?
No, apparently.
Two resolutions.
Okay, yeah. Two resolutions.
Seconded.
Great. Any discussion?
No.
You're ready to vote? All those in favour? That passes unanimously. Trustee Grove.
And that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee advises the Liquor Control and Licensing Branch that it sought to gather the views of residents on application SSLCB 2012.1, Robert Steinbeck, 124 Upper Ganges Road, by posting notice in the Driftwood newspaper for 2 weeks prior to the meeting date. Residents had an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant and provide comments to the planner assigned to the file.
Mr. Seconder?
Seconded.
Is there any discussion? Are you ready to vote? All those in favour? That passes unanimously. Thanks very much to the planner, and thanks for cooperating on the advertising side of things. That was
Thank you for accommodating the request, Emma. Greatly appreciate it.
Okay, great. Thanks for spending your afternoon with us. we're now moving to 14.3, and again, this is Planner Brownrigg's file. This is the development permit amendment, and we'll invite you to introduce your staff report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So this is an amendment to an existing development permit, SSDP 0799, the Summerside Strata at 107 Atkins Road. And the proposal is to amend this development permit to reflect landscaping and paving changes. So this is originally a phased development permit for 51 units. It was issued in August 1999. And this permit amendment was a result of inconsistency between the requirements for the original development permit and the as-built characteristics of the development. In the course of this process, the landscaping plans were not updated. And Islands Trust received a letter of credit in May of 2010 for landscaping, a letter of credit for $9,000. So landscaping has been installed on the site, and Islands Trust will hold the letter of credit until the landscaping has been established for 1 year, pending a report from landscape architects saying that the landscaping that the landscaping has been installed substantially in compliance with the landscaping plans. And an engineer has signed off on the change from turf stone to asphalt, which was one of the original, the seeded turf stone was a condition in the original development permit. In addition, in this development permit amendment, an updated stormwater drainage report will be required prior to the construction of additional phases of this development permit. As noted in the town hall, there are three additional phases of this development that have not been constructed. Also, as mentioned in the town hall, the original development permit amendment that's in the staff report contained a mention of phase six, which the Strata Council has requested be taken out of the development permit amendment. I spoke with the applicant, and they agreed that the reference to phase six could be taken out of the amendment. So there is a memorandum in the late agenda package, which describes this process and includes a revised copy of the development permit that is being proposed to the local trust committee, and a revised recommendation as well. So the revised recommendation is that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee approves issuance of development permit SSDP 2008.4 to King Edward Bay Development for Lot 1, Sections 3 and 4, Range 3 East, North Salt Spring Island, Cowichan District Plan, VIP 75338, except part in Strata Plan, VIS 5366, phases 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, as attached to the April 4th, 2012 memorandum.
Thank you. Is the applicant present?
No.
They are not.
Okay. Any questions from the trustees of the planner?
Does this relate to what you talked to earlier? And you mentioned phase 6. So could I get an explanation either from staff or the person who objected as to how phase 6 would be affected by, because I thought you wanted that excluded.
Your hand.
What would the implication?
We'll go back to the planner here. We only just got the report this morning and haven't had a chance to read it, the revised one, so maybe you could go over that again.
Absolutely. So the phase 6 that's mentioned in this recommendation is not the phase 6 that the Strata Council member was referring to in the town hall. The original phasing plan for this development has been changed multiple times in the course of the development permit amendments. So the phases in the legal description actually refer to all the phases in the development. They've just, little chunks have been broken off through the course of the development permit amendment process. Does that?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah.
So your staff report incorporates the change that was recommended by the Strata Council in the letter that we received this morning and the comments in the town hall. Is that your?
Yes. Just to be very specific so that you understand exactly the process. The development permit amendment, the proposed development permit amendment that is in the staff report that was in the original agenda package in 1.1, if you look at the landscaping and then the first point in the landscaping, it mentions phases 5 and 6. And the amended development permit amendment, I tried to find another word for amendment, but it's the best one, so I used it, removes reference to, so it says phase 5 instead of phases 5 and 6. So that's the change that has been made.
Understood. Thank you.
And the Strata Council is happy with this.
No, I guess without seeing what the actual wording of permit is.
You're on tape, and so is the planner. Okay.
Yeah. So. We'll turn to the planning manager to help us out here.
If it clarifies, the only reason there's a phase 6 in that resolution is reference to a legal description.
Okay.
The development permit that you're dealing with in that is the development permit as attached to the April 4th memo, and the development permit in the memo which you received this morning talks about phase 5 only.
Okay. In that case.
Okay, but can we just maybe just line these up? So page 78 of the agenda is the old development permit that was proposed last week.
Yes.
And the one that's proposed as of this morning is on page 2 of the late handout. And can you just flag for us where the change is? Just so
Absolutely.
We're totally sure where the...
So 2.1, so the two changes right here.
This is for phase 5, and before it said 5 and 6. Got it. So are you there?
Yeah, sure.
In 2.1, it's landscaping work for phases 5 and 6 in the old version,
right.
And the one that is proposed for us for today says phase 5 only.
Correct.
Okay.
Good.
Thank you for being a careful reader, because we need that. Clear?
Yes.
Is anybody willing to propose the staff recommendation attached to the April 4 supplemental report?
This is the recommendation.
This is it, yes, on the wall.
Yes, I'm happy to do that. That the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee approves issuance of development permit SSDP 2008.4 to King Edward Bay Development Corp. for Lot 1, Sections 3 and 4, Range 3 East, North Salt Spring Island, Cowichan District Plan VIP 75338, except part in Strata Plan VIS 5366, phases 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, as attached to the April 4, 2012 memorandum.
Is there a seconder?
Sorry, seconder.
Is there any discussion? I guess I've just got one, is that when the development permit requirement was very specific and then it's not met, and now we're amending something after the fact that's not met. I mean, that's awkward for all of us, that you use asphalt instead of... So Do we have any brilliant ways to avoid this kind of thing ever happening again? Or is this the long conversation that some of the Strata Council members have suggested they'd like to help us out with? I'm seeing nods in the audience. Yeah.
There's more. This only deals with part of.
And
as you correctly stated, it is after fact.
Yeah.
But that small detail was important to clear up.
Yeah, fair enough. I just know we've just been talking about climate change and groundwater protection, and so when we say water permeable surfaces versus asphalt, we really mean it.
Well, but anyway, you do get porous asphalt, and that's probably not being used, but it's available.
This is a point of information. Yeah, definitely. But not what we're dealing with here.
Probably
anyway,
not.
We'll work on that for the next phase. Yeah. Thanks for your sleuthing on this. Any other questions or comments? I'm ready to vote. All those in favor? That passes unanimously. Thanks very much to the planner for your work.
Three planners for their work.
I know, it's terrific. Okay, a team. It's a good thing we've got a team. We're now at 14.4 on the agenda, page 87. And this is Landworks Consultants, Bettis Road.
Got Chris Hall here.
Oh, great. So Chris Hall is our contract planner on this one. We have the applicant represented also in the front row, so we'll do the same thing. We'll invite the planner to come and present the report from Beverly Soderman and Chris Hall, and then we'll give the applicant's representative an opportunity to add anything for the trust committee's benefit.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. Yes, this is here for your consideration for second reading. It's a fairly extensive report, for which we apologize, but nevertheless, it covers all of the details that I'm sure you'd be interested in. So just as a quick overview, this is the application. You can see the property here that's under consideration for rezoning to industrial and amendment for the OCP to recognize it again as industrial. So that's the core of it. The purpose is to make those changes and to amend the bylaw to allow a very specific bylaw zoning for two of the properties involved. To deal with the ale exclusion, and then as a result of that, if all goes well, then the supply center can be under construction. The amendment, as I mentioned, is intended to apply to the entire property. Only a portion of it now is so designated. And again, the zoning will have, there will be two zonings, one for the agri-industrial parcel and one for the balance of the property. So that's a quick synopsis of it. If we go to the next slide, I think it'll show a more recent site plan. This is part of the application for development permits and highlights some of the elements on the site. So if you were to see this building here, that is the new building that is to be constructed as part of the ALC decision for agricultural storage and processing. There's a barn over here, but this whole parcel will be, once the subdivision is concluded, it will be transferred in order to meet the obligations set out by the Land Commission. The balance of the property is bounded by Bettis Road on this side, by the campground on this side. There is a steep ravine in this particular location, and then on this side there is again some industrial land, although it's being used for industrial purposes. This is the landscape plan that has been prepared, and it gives you some sense of what's happening around the perimeter of the site, and identifies a number of the things that we're trying to address in the project through covenants. I'll have a more detailed site plan of the covenant areas later on, but just to illustrate, there's along the roadway, there's an intent to retain as much of the vegetation as possible, some storm drainage works. This area around the creek is to be protected with some fairly significant setbacks. The storage compound, this area here, which is where right now a lot of the gravel surface is that's unused, is where there will continue to be some storage. The building is now located in this area, which is currently being used as their primary storage compound. Fence around the bottom and then a buffer between it and the campground. On this westerly side is a ditch. There was an RER report done for that, and again, that area is to be protected. So that, in essence, is the plan as it now exists in draft form, waiting for a development permit. So the conditions for exclusion are noted here. It was a dedication of the parcel to assist with site preparation and construction, and then to provide an endowment for the produce distribution center. As part of giving a first reading, gave us the opportunity to refer the application out to a variety of agencies, as well as to your advisory committees and commissions. These matters came up, they were anticipated, and so much of the work had already been done on these, but the soil erosion and soil stability matters have now been addressed. The water course, the applicant undertook, there are requirements, and there is protection proposed for that. There's a preliminary stormwater management plan. There's been no contamination found on the site. Groundwater protection will be addressed in part through DPA2 and also through the provincial standards for ensuring that there's no unforeseen activities occurring that would penetrate the groundwater and cause problems. And then there's the ALC conditions and its buffers, and we'll speak a bit to that a little further on. I guess we'll do it right now. The interesting thing about this application is that now that it's being removed from the ALR, we have to deal with the fact that it still abuts ALR lands. And so what are the buffer guidelines that the commission requires? And they have a fairly extensive document outlining what those are. They indicate that the tools are meant to be flexible so that they can be adapted to unique circumstances. So in this particular situation, we're dealing with an urban side non-residential setback buffer. In other words, there isn't adjacent residential lands. The industry that's going on the site is industrial. So the setback for buildings is 15 meters from the boundary, and a buffer width of 8 meters is to be included within that. So if we look at the site, which is the next picture here, this will give you some indication of what the ALC was considering when they prepared this. So this is an illustration of a residential site abutting agricultural land, and you can see that they've identified the buffer. Because this is now, in the case that we're dealing with, this is the slag lumber site, this is the campground site. So the setbacks are somewhat different, and the issue is whether or not the campground site requires a 15 meter buffer, or does the 8 meter buffer satisfy? 15 meter is really a no-build covenant area. So you can see there's a couple of pictures here identifying the site. This is from sort of part way up the hill from the campground, and you can tell that there's a fairly significant bank that drops down here. This site is in fact terraced. There's a terrace here, there's a terrace there, and it continues down. If you look at the next slide, this is facing more towards the south. You can see the fence at the bottom, fairly high fence, and the 8 meter buffer area that the applicant will be looking at and protecting will be just outside of that fence for the 8 meters. So as you continue further down, there's some mature vegetation, again, a steep slope. So while we have, in an abundance of caution, included in our recommendations that you should give consideration to whether or not there's a 15 meter buffer or not, that's something that's under these circumstances you may want to think about. We were marginal on it, so we left it in. Move to the next one. Yeah. So the referral issues identified a number of things. First Nations were concerned about the archaeological implications for the site, and an assessment has been undertaken. We haven't seen the report. The applicant will speak to it. I gather there is some work that has been concluded there. The traffic issue came up a number of years ago when this application was first being considered. There was correspondence in the file concerned about the intersection. The applicant, again, undertook to do the work and have addressed as much as they can address that's specific to the site in this particular case. As you have read in the report, there are a number of things that the Traffic Commission is, or Transportation Commission is anxious to see. The majority of it is beyond the ability of this applicant to take care of. It really involves the CRD, yourselves, and the Ministry of Transportation Infrastructure. The Ministry believes that there's really no necessity for any changes. Nevertheless, the concern has been raised by the public, and so the traffic study has gone to some lengths to try to address that. There was also discussion around the fact that in your OCP, this is a heritage road dedication. There isn't any sort of real firm policy as to what that implies in this particular case. And as a result, there wasn't much that could be done to address that. The applicants certainly have sought to do that by being cognizant of the fact that you want to keep as much vegetation along the road as you can to preserve sort of that rural kind of rustic quality that exists there. The idea of trails has also been raised. Again, it's one of those things that perhaps is going to require additional work by both the both yourselves and MOTI to really flesh out under what circumstances, particularly in rural areas where there is no existing trail network, you would want to encourage this. We would note that the applicant has contributed in the past to trail connections in the community through donations and materials and so forth. Has also in the landscape plan showed how a trail could be incorporated into their frontage or into the road frontage of the property. But at this particular point, our recommendation is that it's a bit beyond the scope of this application to really address that in its fullest sense. So that's, I think, predominantly deals with referral issues. And so we have left with you the recommendation to consider second reading to the bylaw, and as a result of that, being able to schedule a public hearing. We've asked for authorization to seek to the preparation of the covenants, predominantly in accordance with the plans for the buffer, and here's where we'll need your decision, whether we go with 8 or 15. The covenants to protect the spear area along the drainage courses of 10 meters, and a drainage covenant to protect from flooding from top of bank of 7.5 meters. And then any other resolutions that as a result of forthcoming work, such as the archaeological study that might be necessary in order to get this on the table with as much information as we can for public hearing and third reading. And this basically shows the covenants that we are anticipating. So this one is the area setback around the creek and the top of bank setback. So from top of bank to creek is actually a fair distance. So in this area, there's lots of coverage of and protection also of the agricultural area that is immediately to the south is actually being used for agriculture. What we're showing here is what the 8-meter buffer is, which we're suggesting as a minimum for the setback against the campground property. And then along this side of the property, area B, it's the 10-meter setback required for the SPIA protection under the RAR report. And I believe that's all for slides. Oh, no, one more, sorry. So just to conclude, basically all of these various elements of the project, the subdivision, the bylaws, contribution of land, and so forth, have to be dealt with in together. It's going to require that various parties and jurisdictions work together. We've sought to see if we can't conclude any of the approvals that don't need others' approval first, because that helps it along, and the development permit is the one that comes primarily to mind, but then to utilize legal mechanisms to make sure that everything is done as we're presenting it to you. I'm positive that's the last one.
That's the last one.
Yeah, recognize the planning manager.
We had a brief discussion this morning about covenants, and so I think it's worthy of taking the time to speak just a little bit further about these covenants. This work was directed by the LTC at last meeting, that you wanted a report showing the overlap of what is going to happen in the development permit, what's going to happen in the subdivision, what certainty you have at different steps of the process that these things will be attended to. One of the things that one of the reasons for bringing forward this conversation on covenants is that if you wish to attach as a condition of rezoning approval the entering into a covenant with LTC, then it's good practice to say that prior to public hearing so that people in the public hearing know that you fully intend to enter into a covenant. So that's why this presentation speaks to covenants and why I also want the opportunity to speak to these three. We, Bev, upon completing the report with Chris and in consultation with Kelly, has spent a lot of time looking at all of the overlapping jurisdictions. And a real question was posed in my mind as to whether LTC needed to enter into any of the covenants. So could I just speak to these three a little bit further? Area A is an area where Ministry of Transportation requires a flood covenant of some 15 meters and will only, Ministry of Transportation will enter into that flood covenant and they will not hand over that jurisdiction to us. Ministry of Transportation in the subdivision process has also asked for a 7.5 meter covenant, as shown in green here. And should the LTC enter into a covenant on the 7.5 no vegetation removal, then MOT will take that out of its requirements. So it's in your discretion whether you want to take that green covenant or not. If you don't take it, Ministry of Transportation will take that covenant for no vegetation removal and make it a requirement of subdivision.
I'm just going to add to that one as well. I understand that the CRD is also interested in the flood protection covenants.
Yes.
But I'm not interested in the vegetation covenant.
Okay. Area A is the drainage course that leads downhill, and in considering this application at community meetings, you've heard from a downstream property owner, being the Sail Club, asking if some of the sedimentation is coming off of this property or not. So the applicant did a voluntary riparian area assessment and storm drainage assessment to address this drainage course. It is not one that is picked up as a drainage course by Ministry of Transportation, but the riparian area assessment does recommend this 10 meter spia from high water mark. So nobody else is at this point in time requiring that. If you wish that, or if the community would benefit from that, the applicant is prepared to enter into a covenant with LTC to provide by covenant the results of that SPIA and that RAR work. So that is one that, if it's going to be had, it's going to be by your interest at end of public hearing of taking a covenant with respect to the 10 meter area B. Area C is an area that reflects the Land Commission guidelines. It's in their approval several years ago, they noted that setbacks would be determined at time of a development permit stage. I don't know as to why they used that wording. We do not have development permits that require setbacks from agricultural land reserve. So if you do wish to implement buffer specifications as generically recommended by the Land Commission, you would have to do so as a condition of zoning approval. By virtue of the fact that staff and the consultants believe that there is interest in going forward on Area B under a covenant, and the only group that would hold that covenant supposedly would be Islands Trust, that's kind of a no vegetation or a vegetation management covenant. That same covenant wording would be very, it reflects the intent of the green area A. So one covenant with LTC could handle both. It would not be a duplication. Then Ministry of Transportation would pull back. You wouldn't be duplicating another requirement. And area C, again, that The 8 meters is kind of a don't remove the vegetation, so that would be very similar wording. So if I've got it right, the applicant has indicated that instead of having vegetation management with two or three different covenant holders, they would be amenable to Islands Trust holding the covenant dealing with don't remove the vegetation around the perimeter of this site. So I hope that is worthy further explanation, that's all I wanted to add.
Thanks. I'll invite the applicant's representative to add anything to the planner's report for the Trust Committee's benefit.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Trustees, I have a lead apology to make. Mark Rithler is not here, and it's not because he's not interested. He didn't want you to think that, so he asked me to let you know that his mom died on Tuesday. Secondly, I will verbally report, as promised in the staff report there, on the committee information meeting that we held a week ago today. We were very pleasantly surprised at the turnout. There were at least 40 people, more than 40 people there, 33 of whom signed in. And the overwhelming response was positive and supportive. Two people raised concerns about the Bettis Road Fulford Ganges intersection, and one person raised a concern about increased traffic on the upper part of Bettis Road, both of which we had anticipated and have heard in the past and have tried to deal with in our traffic impact study. The archaeological inspection took place about 2 weeks ago, and I have an email, plus I've seen the draft report. There were no archaeological signs, indications, culturally modified trees, shell middens, nothing to be found. So no further action is recommended. However, Mark has a standing order to all people working on site. If anything is ever found, work will be stopped immediately. And that includes excavation when they start putting the foundations in for the building. I would like to address the ALC's guidelines, which Chris showed you both a chart and an illustration. The guidelines are intended, as you probably saw, for situations where urban residential development is encroaching upon working farmland. And the whole idea is for the protection of an agricultural operation. I don't honestly believe there is an agricultural operation in the area to the south here, or ever will be. And this may or may not be seen as urban. It's certainly not residential. So protecting this from residential encroachment is kind of a moot point. But we're fully prepared to, for the sake of being good neighbors, to maintain an 8-meter vegetated buffer here. And I don't want to give you the impression that we'll retain every alder that's there, but we will beef up this so it's more a vegetation management than a vegetation preservation area. We have met with the neighbor, Ian Kyle, twice, and have his wish list, if you will, and we'll try our best to do that. The fence, which now exists from about here to here, it's an 8-foot fence, so almost 2.5 meter high fence, which was erected on a shared responsibility basis. Slade provided the materials, and Mr. Kyle provided the labor to erect the fence. He has planted some Lombardy poplars on this side and will be planting some coniferous trees. He has asked, we initially showed honey locusts on this side of the property. He has said that probably coniferous would be provide a better screen, so we will adhere to that request and we'll plant coniferous trees there. MOTI, so let me finish off this. So I guess my thinking with regards to the 15-meter building setback is we're well within that. We're adhering to that. But building setbacks are normally included in your zoning bylaw, and if you want to increase building setbacks from industrial uses and non-industrial uses, then it should be done in the zoning bylaw. So if there ever were a case where this did become a working farm, agricultural operation, and this were ever to be converted to residential use, then you would want that 15-meter building setback. However, in order for that to happen, this would have to go through a rezoning from industrial to residential. So my request is that we're respecting the 15-meter setback. Do you need to enshrine it at this point? I don't believe so. So with regards to the covenants, MOTI, as Chris said, they requires a no-build floodproof covenant, which is 15 meters from the top of the bank, so which actually comes up here somewhere. And that's a given. So we're clear. It's between MOTI, the CRD, and Venice Development, and it just covers this one area. But as Leah and Chris both explained, we do want vegetation in it. MOTI would like this vegetation retained. However, if the Islands Trust wishes meet or exceed MOTI's, then they don't need to be party to it. So therefore, if you wish to maintain vegetation management along the drainage ditch and along the southern boundary, why not roll it into one? I've been calling it the vegetation covenant, so, and we're happy to do that. What else? In your report, there is a suggestion that a southbound left turn lane on Fulford Ganges turning onto Bettis should be looked at in terms of when it would be required. But my thinking is that at this point in time, that would be a desktop exercise using a transportation model where you plug in certain assumptions and out comes your answer. Your left turn lane is going to be needed in 2053 or whatever. But there are so many variables in that kind of modeling that not, and the left turn lane, obviously, in MOTI's view, is not needed now. So it's kind of beyond the scope of this project, and whether it needs to be done now is, it's an academic exercise. Another request that we would have is that we are working with staff to try and schedule a public hearing sooner rather than later, so we're happy with that process as well. We have identified, as Leah said, that the development permit is probably the single thing that could happen without all of the dominoes that are sort of interrelated happening, so we'd like to proceed with the development permit. We can get the restrictive covenants signed and ready for registration on title. So we're trying to move to the point where all of the other requirements are sitting on the lawyer's desk, who will give an undertaking to the trust, if you want to hold this covenant, to MOTI and to the ALC, so that it all has to happen within seconds of each other.
Questions from the trustees?
For the planner, probably. What is the implication of a covenant, of the kinds of covenant we're talking about to the trust?
This is a vegetation management covenant. It's not a conservation covenant, so it's not one that we would bring forward a recommendation on monitoring and rent charge and that sort of thing. It's, as it was described, it's a contract with local trust committee that vegetation will be maintained along the property lines.
By whom?
By the property owner.
Okay.
And it's managed similar to how we managed the development permits. A development permit will be issued that will have a storm drainage report saying, you know, this is how the storm drainage system needs to be designed, installed, and of course maintained.
But why does one need to call it a covenant? Why can't it just be a requirement? I mean, I'm nervous of the word, I think. It sounds like I don't need to be.
Typically, it's put on title so that any prospective owners, prospective purchasers, or future owners understand that there's an obligation. So that's really there for that primary purpose.
Okay. So to be on title, I see.
The covenant is a mechanism which allows that requirement to be passed on with the sale of the property.
Thank you. I understand that. Yeah. Thank you.
Can maybe give the Trustee Grove a little bit of reassurance that the advice we tend to get from planners is everything that can go into zoning will be put into zoning. Covenants are used sparingly only when there are issues that really don't fall within the power of zoning to use.
Yes, is that fair? Yeah.
I understand. Thank you.
Trustee Graham, any questions for the planner or the...
A couple of points. I'm quite happy to accept planners' recommendations with regard to the depths of buffer zones. I don't know enough to interfere with that specialised knowledge. On having several covenanters, so to speak, I think that doesn't make a lot of sense, having Moti and half a dozen others. But if it's the local trust committee that's covenanted instead of Moti, and Peter and I have to get our sides out or go clear ditches, then I'm not for that. So if there's no maintenance implication, then I think it makes sense. But if there is, let's leave Ministry of Transport to do it.
So I think in these cases, though, the responsibility is the landowners. And you are the holder of the commitment, and in this case, the recommendation that it is that it is locally controlled as opposed to in the province's area to regulate it. And
so, just to hammer it down one more time, there's no downside to the trust to being on this covenant.
Only if it became a legal argument, say somebody went in and willingly ignored the covenant and there was a complaint about it, then you would be obligated to sort of take some action.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions of the planner or the applicant?
No, I don't think so.
I've got a couple. Sometimes First Nations referral responses, we have a hard time even receiving them. I mean, it's hard for them. And in this case, Lyaxum has just done this beautiful job of reading our official community plan and giving us suggestions about green roofs. And I guess more than anything, I just want to acknowledge that they've really gone beyond. I think they've given some great suggestions. I guess I take the planner's advice that we could put a framework in which all developments within a certain area are required to bump up that green technology, but I take your advice that this application isn't necessarily the one to test drive that on. But I just really want to flag both for the public and for the trustees that there's some really good ideas in here, and we do now have quite recently the ability to specify those kind of things. So thanks to Lyaxum, that's one. I guess the second is around because you've been able to give us verbally the initial results of the archaeological study, I'm feeling happier about that, because I also just want to make sure, I mean, the partnership with First Nations is important, and I don't want to rush to a public hearing if we don't yet have that information, but it looks like that will soon be on the public record, and it looks like the news is good, that there isn't going to be a barrier there.
I just have to add that it was an archaeologist from Madrone out of Duncan, as well as a First Nations, qualified First Nations person also.
Great, okay, excellent. And then I think the final one is just a flag on page 15 of the staff report to some of the planner's comments, which I appreciate the caution around new information around the public hearing. But I just want to sort of state my understanding is that if there's new information, it doesn't necessarily mean that we trigger a public hearing. That the planners, if someone does bring in some new ideas or evidence, that we do rely on the planning staff to assess whether it actually is important enough or would change any of the conditions. So it's to me, it isn't quite as black and white as it looks here. And again, I just don't want members of the public who don't take our deadline seriously and then, you know, bring in a newspaper article the day after the public hearing. It doesn't mean we have to start the process over again.
Yeah, just to add to that, I think it's primarily caution to staff and ourselves and the applicant that if there's information that comes up at a public hearing that somebody has found out about and we haven't shared it with you, then that's potentially problematic. But other than that, I really think we've made an effort, the applicants made an effort to provide as much commentary as we can so that criticism wouldn't arise at a public hearing.
Yeah, that's good. But in any case, it is assessed on a case-by-case basis, and we're in good hands on that one. Are there any other questions or concerns from the trustees? If not, are you willing to start to go through this list?
Sorry, that's my concern.
What's your concern?
Have you got it on your machine?
Yes, I do.
Let's start off. And when you're tired, let me know.
Okay. I move, one, that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee give second reading to proposed bylaw 457, cited as Salt Spring Island Official Community Plan 2008, Amendment Number 1, 2012, open brackets, SS-RZ-2008-R, Landworks Consultants Limited, Bedis Developments, 201-225, Bedis Road, Salt Spring Island, close brackets.
Is there a seconder?
Yes.
Is there any discussion? Are you ready to vote? All those in favour? That passes unanimously. And I'm going to suggest that for the following ones, you don't need to put the citation in the round brackets.
Oh, good.
We'll ask the minute taker to include them, but they don't have to be part of the statutory.
Good. Is that a general rule we can follow in future?
When you're doing repeated ones like this, I think that's right. But it is also because we are transparently governing. We do want there to be, you know, a record on the videotape of what we've done. So there's the rationale. The second.
I move, two, that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee give second reading to proposed bylaw number 458, cited as Salt Spring Island Land Use Bylaw 1999, amendment number 2, 2012, ..
I second that.
Any discussion? Ready to vote? All those in favour? Passes unanimously.
I move, three, that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee gives second reading to proposed bylaw number 459, cited as Salt Spring Island Land Use Bylaw 1999, amendment number 3, 2012.
I second that.
You ready to vote? All those in favour? That passes unanimously.
I move that the Salt Spring Island four, that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee directs staff to schedule a public hearing for proposed bylaws 457, 458, and 459 as soon as possible, preferably the first week of June.
I second that.
Ready to vote? Oh, pardon me, we're going to have a little discussion.
Yeah. I'm not sure it's really necessary to include the preferably portion because there may be an opportunity to do it sooner.
Thank you. Okay. By consent, are the trustees okay with removing the words preferably the first week of June?
Yes.
From the resolution?
Or we could put in preferably by the first week of June and then we can do it sooner.
I think that regardless, we don't usually have to specify the date.
As soon as possible.
All right.
As soon as possible is what it is. So that's moved and seconded as soon as possible. Is there any discussion? Ready to vote?
Yes.
All those in favour? Passes unanimously.
I move, five, that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee direct staff to inform First Nations about the results of the archaeology study once known and notify them about the scheduling of the public hearing.
Second.
You ready to vote?
Yes.
All those in favour? That passes unanimously.
I move, six, that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee direct staff to prepare covenants and draft form preparatory to the public hearing for the following purposes. No build setbacks from the new ALR boundary, :15 metres with an 8-metre buffer requirement. No build and no vegetation removal setbacks from the unnamed stream on the western boundary of the subject property per the recommendations of the RAR, :10 metres. No build setbacks from the top of the ravine on unstable slopes on the eastern side of the property, :15 metres from the top of the ravine. No vegetation removal setback from the top of the ravine, :7.5 metres. Any other natural areas protection requirements that may be
identified? I'm sorry, I'm just going to interrupt you there. The planner's trying to get my attention here.
Actually, carry on, and then I'll ask for a point of clarification. Thank you.
Okay. Pardon me. Go ahead.
Any other natural areas protection requirements that may be identified, which may include items such as the protection of mature vegetation, RAR site inspection and monitoring within the MOE's specified time frame.
Is there a seconder?
Yes.
So, discussion. apologies, I should have clarified with the planner prior to this whether we were going to modify this resolution. And I guess the question is it your intent that all of the covenants be available for public hearing viewing, or just those that the LTC will enter into?
I think probably they're so similar that it's not going to be problematic to have them all prepared.
Okay, so the MOTI ones. Okay, and then the, so that takes care of bullet number three, that would be the MOTI bullet. Bullet number four, or five, other natural areas protection requirements, I don't think we identified any today.
No, we didn't. I think the only reason that was put in was whether or not there was any provision, say, under the archaeological assessment for
okay.
protection of something, but in the absence of that, we wouldn't have any further ones. It was really a bit of a catch-all. In the event that something cropped up.
Okay, so any, and then the RAR site inspection, it was a voluntary RAR, so I think staff have expressed some discomfort at making a requirement with respect to RAR site inspection. So by consent, they might remove that final bullet. And should discuss whether the first bullet is 15 meters or 8 meters.
Could you say the final one again, the RAR one? I didn't follow.
The RAR work was done voluntarily. This is not a RAR-designated watershed by Ministry of Environment. And the water course, which is of interest to downstream property owners, is not a water course that has been picked up by Ministry of Transportation nor Ministry of Environment. So it's entirely a voluntary vegetation management, although it was done by a qualified environmental professional to the standards of a RAR report, but it's not been recognized by Ministry of Environment as a fish-bearing water course.
Fish. Where does the covenant, which one is it? B, the blue one on the left, where does that get captured?
That's the that's the 10-meter no build on the unnamed stream on the western boundary.
Okay.
Bullet number two is that.
So that was that originated from the RAR report, but that second bullet is distinct from the final bullet.
Yeah.
Well, they are distinct. The final one suggests to address whatever the RAR report had, and is so. And it's been a while since I've read it, but I believe the majority of that monitoring had to do with ensuring that there was a stormwater management on the property that did not sort of create a further problem with that creek. And there is a stormwater management plan being prepared under DPA 2, so some of their concern would have been captured within that.
So we're in another process on that one.
That's correct.
Any questions for Trustee Grove?
I'm having a bit of a problem understanding this. So we are going to direct staff to prepare a covenant which doesn't give us any description of that covenant. I mean, and in exchange for that, we're going to give up all these good things with specific measurements which would otherwise be required. But the covenant doesn't tell us what the covenant covers.
But it will in due course.
That's what we're asking them to do. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is the list that will be, if I understand it correctly, you've encapsulated all the items identified in the staff report that could be put into a covenant, and this is the
summary.
That will be put into a covenant.
Yeah. Well, we have to adopt the covenant as well, and that will be part of
next
further
time.
Scrutiny.
And that'll be next time?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
The planner again?
Thank you. The majority of this really is vegetation management covenant. The only one that's not is whether you choose or not to include a 15-meter building setback. And as the applicant pointed out, you have another option of doing that through zoning, in which case you need to amend your zoning bylaw.
Should we not call it a vegetation management covenant?
Yeah. A vegetation management covenant.
If that's what it is?
Yep, that's fine.
I don't want to make complications where there aren't any. So,
yeah.
But
Well, we've got, this is the motion we've got on the floor.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this was the staff recommendation. We could amend the motion we've got on the floor if the staff advice has changed.
I'm easy. I'm just bringing. I'm just raising it.
Yeah, I know. They're good questions.
So we have to take direction from staff. If it's going to come up next at the next meeting, and it's going to be called a vegetation coverage covenant, then that's fine.
But I think this is adequate for the purposes of staff designing covenants.
Then let's leave it.
So the final bullet is the one around RAR, which may be duplicative. So if we pass this resolution as it is, might we get the advice when the draft covenant is presented to the trust committee that the items in the final bullet around RAR are recommended to be dealt with through the development permit process?
Yes. Or you can remove them at the time the covenant's being prepared. Yeah. So we'll give you that option.
Okay. So that sounds like an option. You know, we could amend the motion by removing that final bullet, or we could leave it in staff's hands to advise us at the next time.
Yeah, as with everything else.
And then the other, I think, is in the very first bullet, which is the issue around the 15 meters, which the applicant's representative was suggesting that we might simply rely on the 8-meter buffer. Is that fair? And in this case, then we might just remove 15 meters from this first, the text of the first bullet?
I wouldn't change the text to any of this. I mean, I think the plan is getting the message, and we'll see what we see next time.
Are you happy to?
It's the planning managers.
Yeah, that's fine. All of this will be ready by public hearing, and it can be openly discussed further at public hearing. And
That's the way I think.
Okay, so we've got motion on the floor, and we'll leave the text as is.
Yes.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Are you ready to vote? All those in favor? Passes unanimously. Thanks for all the support on that one.
I move 7 that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee require the applicant to provide to the Local Trust Committee prior to final adoption an analysis of the southbound left turn movement at the Bed SFGR Charlesworth intersection for information purposes so as to determine when a separate left turn lane may be warranted for this movement in Fulford Ganges Road to be shared with the SSI Transportation Commission and the Ministry of Transportation and Infrastructure.
Second.
Any discussion?
Nothing really informs it. It's not the left turn that's the problem, it's the right turn as you're going in the other direction, but that's not going to be.
A point of clarification, what's being shared with the Transportation Committee in the Ministry of Transportation?
The analysis, right?
Oh, I see. Okay. Right. Thank you.
I'm a planning manager.
I could actually hold this comment to public hearing. Recognizing that the way that this timing happens is after public hearing, you would make a condition of final adoption that there be a transportation study done, shared with others. You would not have opportunity to go back and revisit the conditions of zoning and make any conditions or attach any conditions to adoption. So it would simply be saying, do another report, give it to other bodies, which those bodies may find a bit frustrating. So if your other option is to, if you think this is paramount, your other option is to require it be done prior to public hearing. But our consulting team has not recommended that.
I don't think that's necessary.
I just caution that one thing, that it sometimes looks like a bit of a paper exercise.
I'm happy with the resolution as it stands.
Okay.
And the final course of action, again, I'm not anticipating anything here, but if what you got post-public hearing was so shocking and compelling, you could always asked to have an additional public hearing scheduled. It doesn't happen very often, but if you really did need to look at new conditions.
Okay, thank you.
Is there any further discussion on this item? Are you ready to vote?
Yes.
All those in favour? Passes unanimously.
And I move 8 that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee directs staff to prepare a resolution for third reading that enables LTC to establish the conditions for bylaw approval that will at a minimum address the results of the archaeological investigation of any action by the LTC is required. The recommendations of the Bunt traffic study is reflected in the comments of the SSI Transportation Commission. The covenants for natural areas protection and ALR buffering.
Second that.
Can I ask the minute taker on this one to insert in there somewhere the reference to the application number? That's the one that we have it missing.
Yes.
Thank you. Is there any discussion? Are you ready to vote? All those in favor? Passes unanimously. Fantastic. What nicely written resolutions. Thank you very much.
So I do think the driftwood should offer roses to all those members of the public who've sat through that.
I know. Yeah, it's really exciting work, isn't it? All right. Thank you very much to all the planners on all these files. Trustees, do you want to stretch your legs for a minute before we go into our conference?
No, I'm good. Yeah. I'm good for this minute.
Very good? Okay, this
in
minute.
Minute
you will let us know if it's otherwise. Okay, then we are moving right along. 15.1, page 113 of the agenda package is the Local Trust Committee video recording pilot results. And we'll turn to Planning Manager Hartley to introduce her report.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and gee, I hope the recording's working right now, because I hope to share a little bit further elaboration based on one particular part that we learned in this pilot, being the editing. But I'll start at the beginning of this report. And I should mention that express appreciation to three other staff members that assisted in considering this report and suggesting amendments to the report. I shared it with our senior management team in Victoria, recognizing, of course, that this is a bit of work that other LTCs will be interested in, and ultimately all of our local government operations and our decision making may benefit from what you have found here today, or in the last 3 months. So this report, its purpose is to allow LTC to consider the results and to evaluate the success of the pilot, and to consider whether you wish to extend video recording as a regular part of your meeting service. Should you wish to extend it and give clear direction as to the nature of that service, then it's the intent that staff would prepare the documents for a proposal call, allowing you to receive bids on a full year of service, and for this to continue. But that's getting ahead of myself. That's getting to the final recommendation prepared for your consideration. Going back a bit, the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee placed high priority on improving communication with the public. It recognized that local governments are increasingly turning to video recording service. We initially looked at 10 local governments about the same size as Salt Spring Island. We found that 5 of those local governments did have their meetings supported by video recording service. We found that 5 did not have that service, and noted that it seemed to be a function of perhaps population size, and also a function of whether there was a media service covering the meetings and offering it. We noted a cable company that routinely did this for many, many local governments, and it's still media that covers many of the local governments across British Columbia. We ran a 2-month trial service extended to 3 months through an open competition. We received several proposals. We awarded it to VQ Media, Peter Prince, who is here today with us. This report is based on the first 3 meetings and findings of the first 3 meetings. There is a report from the video recording contractor attached. There's a 2-page where Peter has documented what equipment he has used, and also provides comments with respect to the meeting location and the setup that may enhance the production and the recording ease of viewing after the meeting from people's homes or business. We He has provided us with detailed statistics on each segment. There's a software tool, Google Analytics, that allows tracking of the number of views of each segment once it's posted, where people are accessing the website from and the video recording from, and the duration of the views. So in my summary report, I've talked a little bit about what we have found in terms of the number of views. When this report was being written a week ago, we noted that the February 2nd afternoon segment, which is our applications, had recorded the most number of views, 176 views to that segment. Also, a week ago, when we looked at the March 15th meeting, which had been up for a week, we noticed that there were 24 viewers of the morning segment, 32 of the delegations and town hall segment, and 23 viewers of the afternoon application segment. The report itself, I'm not going to go into. There's obviously, I spent some time documenting sort of how we set this up and what the logistics are, and not necessarily new information to you, but I just thought for the record it would be helpful to have this. What is important in terms of the one of the things I will focus on is there's the service that we see here today by a video recorder being in the room with us for 8 hours or so. And in order that is posted on the web next week, on the Tuesday, although next week it'll be Wednesday because of the holiday weekend, Peter is, over the course of the weekend, doing quite a bit of work in terms of setting up the production. And then on the Monday, he's finding a server with high-speed connection in order to put that up on YouTube and then have it viewed. But upon conclusion of this meeting, before the end of the weekend, there's an additional, well, he could tell you how many hours. It's more than 2 or 3 hours work of done before the start of the next week. In terms of the financial part of the pilot, the initial contract, I forget the figures, if we were to continue this current level of service, it would be in the range of $15,000 per year, we anticipate, but that would be subject to an open competition, seeking a proposal for 17 meetings over the course of the year. In addition to the contract costs, there are hard costs and human resource costs attached to the service. There is some staff time attached to the service. We estimate it on a run-of-the-mill kind of meeting, no contentious issues, nothing changed, nothing new. There might be about 3 hours of staff time attached to the service over and beyond the staff time traditionally attached to the LTC meetings. There is some storage costs for the tapes, which our staff person in Victoria has estimated very roughly at about $2,000 per year. One of the requests has been, instead of posting this on YouTube, could you post it on the new Salt Spring or the new Islands Trust website when it is launched? And he notes that yes, you could, but then your additional storage costs, he estimates to be an additional $1,000 per year if you were to put it on the website. The new website does not have the capability for files this large, together with everything else that's already going on to the website. If the service was expanded to include meetings like last night's affordable housing special meeting, then that's going to be additional costs. On the flip side, if you try to say, let's get some cost savings, then you could look at either a lower quality of production, of display. You could look at an audio-only recording. You could look at doing a recording with an unmanned camera, so somebody coming in, positioning the camera, and then departing. We'd perhaps have to talk with that contractor about, you know, how long do the tapes run, how often do they have to be replaced, who do we have here who can replace those tapes during the meeting, that sort of thing. Or the other thing to note is that an option open to you is to set this up as a live stream only, such that you are not doing any post-meeting production work or web work. Now, that doesn't give anyone the opportunity to see. They would have to be watching it from their computer either while the meeting goes on. They could connect right now and see this meeting as it happens right now. The post-meeting viewing, if they wanted to see it next week, would require an individual to set their machine at home to do the recording, and then to save that file and watch it from their own at their own time in the coming weeks. There are, of course, further enhanced levels of service. I haven't gone into too many details of that simply because of the starting to watch the budget on this. I will speak to something that was raised, two meetings ago, last meeting, and again here. That is what happened during a pilot situation, this pilot initiative, when we came to a difficult decision about the remarks during town hall. And I don't want to get into whose remarks, what express remarks or whatever. We came to the situation, we were advised over the late Friday of a concern. Our CAO on Monday was, or Tuesday, was brought into the discussion. What do we do? At that point in time, I was working with our contractor to say, okay, if we have to edit, what options do we have? What do we do? And I was presented with a list of options. There are things that could have been done which would have allowed a very small edit. Probably couldn't have even seen it, discerned it. You would have had to have known that that was going on. That would have required the file going back to the production studio, work being done, and then come back and load. So that would have entailed another day. We were already one day delayed. That would have entailed another day. I think that's something that we can predict may happen again in the future, and we'd want to put other provisions in place. This was a pilot, a budget at the end of the year. The other option on the total flip side was, do you just remove a segment? While loading up on YouTube, do you remove a whole segment? So that is what I chose at the time, recognizing that that decision was going to draw the most criticism. And if we were not comfortable with that decision, then it's in the hands of LTC to say, next time we would like in our service delivery for something else to be done. So I deliberately made a choice to select between options that which entailed the least amount of cost and would draw the most criticism from the community, if it is a concern to the community. So it has led to very much of this discussion that we've had today as to what do you do in that situation. And so it's I offer to those that were caught, those seven persons caught in that big edit, I offer apologies for the fact that they are not captured by that video recording. I hope that this explanation helps people to understand why the decision was made between several different options. Primarily, I hope that it allows LTC to decide how best to proceed. I myself do not like doing edits. I would rather we not get into the process of doing edits. And I'm very concerned, I was very concerned at the time of doing it, recognizing that the reason for bringing in this service is to reestablish rapport with the community, reestablish trust, and I recognize that any edits start to diminish that trust. I should mention as well that in making that decision, I was cognizant of the other services that had been operating previous to this, the privately operated services, and recognizing that previous video production seemed to have encountered the same dilemma and were taking steps similar to what I was taking to really post segments of the meeting rather than the entire meeting. I don't know if it's for file size, but I believe it's also with some sensitivity to these things crop up from time to time. So it's a bit of a dilemma, and we could seek further advice with respect to this. We could look at the operations of our meeting, the scheduling of things of our meeting, but I certainly welcome the perspective of trustees with respect to this. And what I don't want to do is to in any way say that we have the expertise to be able to say, oh yeah, we can leave a meeting and at 5 o'clock say, boy, this part here has to be edited, this part there has to be edited, and overnight the production will be happening, you'll get it up the next day. We just don't have that kind of expertise in-house to be able to offer that level of service. If edits happen, they will be costly in terms of staff time and probably require kind of post-production, go back and redo.
Comments, questions, next steps from the trustees?
Yes. I've given this some considerable thought as well. And the first thing I'd like to do is to thank Peter, because I think his service has been exemplary. I think it's been sterling. It's been an example of professionalism. It's highly competent, and I'm very grateful. I don't want any censorship to occur of videotaping. Any at all. I think if someone is stupid enough to stand up and defame somebody else, then in some ways they deserve what's coming to them. However, it isn't satisfactory if a byproduct of that defamation is that the trust lands itself in trouble. Now, the legal advice that emerged during the event that two meetings ago that Leah alluded to implied or stated that the media seem to have exemptions from, or they have immunities that the trust and other organisations do not. In other words, if the media were to host those recordings, they could do so without the same concerns for being sued by third parties that the trust is subject to. Now, there are a number of ways, I think, therefore, to facilitate that. And I took the liberty of having a discussion with Amber Ogilvie, the publisher of The Driftwood, to see if they had an interest in videotaping. Because, of deep interest to the community. There's no doubt about that. The community want these recordings. We've had that express interest, and that's been reaffirmed by our very recent poll on the Driftwood. So regardless of the cost, not regardless, but within reasonable cost, I think we have to undertake these recordings. If somehow we can construct an arrangement with the Driftwood So they undertake the recordings, they host it on their website rather than on the trust's website. It seems to me that would relieve the trust entirely from liability should there be a defamation statement made by a third party, and the driftwood should be protected by its immunity laws. And if it isn't, they can do their own editing to protect themselves, but then there is no allegation that this has been undertaken by the trust in order to conceal information from the community. Now, I don't know the legal implications of this. Amber has expressed an interest in doing this. We haven't got past that. But I think it's worth staff entering a dialogue with the driftwood to see whether it's possible to put together some sort of arrangement. Clearly, trust lawyers will have to pass judgment on it. But if in entering a contract, then the trust would have the power to instruct the driftwood to edit sections out, I think that is also unsatisfactory. But maybe a grant, for example, to facilitate this type of thing as part of our community engagement exercise, something out of the budget there, so that we don't enter such a definitive contract that would constrain us in that way. If that doesn't work, I don't know how we engineer, but that's as far as I've got. And another option is you becoming a member of the National Union of Journalists. But I think that is a possible workable solution. I would, with the will of the driftwood, with the will of the local trust committee, with the patience of the community, maybe we can put something together.
Well, I think that's an excellent suggestion, George. But based upon what we're doing now, I mean, I really like the current level of service. I think we're doing what we set out to do. And again, I agree, Peter, you're doing a terrific job on this. So I'm very happy with what we're doing and how we're doing it. I mean, other than for our glitch, the glitch or the rock that we've hit on this pilot project. The driftwood plan can be made to work, I think that would be a wonderful solution. If not, I think we have to get advice from our lawyers as to how we can proceed and look after, then ensure the trust's legal positions are protected. I wonder what other places do. I mean, North Saanich, where we hear of quite a bit, they've got a program and a project that's been going on. How do they deal with these legal issues?
We asked them that very question, and the administrator expressed that they hadn't given a whole lot of thought to what happens, and conclude they would probably have to do the same as we have done of just ask for an edit, recognizing that there is legislation dealing with local governments, which. Is different than that of other organizations, and we do have to, I guess, be cautious about defamation. And it's not what I'm not in any way saying that that the statements were libelous. This
yes,
was when we heard that it was potentially that we started to ask the questions. I myself did not leave that meeting saying, oh, geez, you know, we have to edit. We probably could have avoided some of the dilemma by taking a look at it on the Friday.
You were correct to ask the questions, and you were correct to seek advice from Victoria.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I have no concerns in that regard. And you did what you did for the right reasons. So I urge you to press on, look at the alternatives, certainly pursue the driftwood option if that is an option. Get legal advice as to how we deal with this in the future. Two basic questions. Under the present situation, I mean, what happens if Peter is not available, if he's sick or runs off to Mexico? I mean, is there a backup right now?
In the pilot, we didn't. Okay. We weren't concerned about that for the 2 month term
of the pilot. So we
need
to consider a backup.
But you would certainly need to consider it if running it for.
And the other is the cost of storage, 2,000 or 3,000 a year. That seems very high. What are we storing and how? I mean, storage is cheap these days, so
it
should be.
It's the cost of the tapes. I think they're $150 a tape, is what I've been told.
Don't you store these things digitally now? I mean, I don't know about this stuff.
That's digital tapes, isn't it?
I think.
Yeah, because you reuse them.
May I answer?
Yes, please.
Please.
I record direct to disk, and I also record to tape at the same time because that's my backup. There was one glitch earlier where, and it's good I had the tapes going. So I cover myself.
But storing this stuff, Peter,
well,
I mean, how do you...
Storing it, it's certainly not my... I'm not storing it, the trust
no,
is...
No, I know you're not.
I heard they didn't use tapes anymore. I don't know what tapes they need. I'm not giving them tapes, I'm giving them files.
Well, it's maybe the additional storage that's required in the server, actually. The trust has to buy additional storage.
Seems expensive as well.
Yeah. This, you know, if we are going to carry on with this, we could ask for some more staff advice on that. I'm not sure we can work it out.
The responsibility becomes the Driftwood, and I think it would have to, because they would have to be the ones to host it if they are going to be protected by the immunity, then it wouldn't be an issue for us. It'll simply be included in the price that attaches to a quotation that would come from them, or in some sort of arrangements that we can construct.
Peter has a question.
There's no cost to storing it on YouTube. Mm-hmm. They don't charge you anything for that. And if I weren't able to be here, I would send someone who was just as capable as myself to do the camera if I was sick or otherwise incapable of being here.
It's a contract, so we appreciate that.
I have no other question.
I mean, there are other arrangements. If the Driftwood didn't want to invest in the hardware, if some... linked arrangement whereby we contract with the Driftwood contract with Peter. I mean, all sorts of permutations are possible, but I think would allow this to happen. It's what I tried to look at was a means of utilizing their immunity in order to remove the need to censor.
So I think this is an important enough question that it makes sense for us to ask specifically for advice on that proposal and whether it does both remove the need to edit some public comments and whether it protects the organization from legal challenge. And it's an important question.
Seems to me that we're not ready to make this recommendation yet. So it seems to me what we should do is extend the present service for whatever time the year thinks that we need.
It's extended at the moment to the end of April, I believe. So we have one more meeting that we could do that in. I believe that we need a resolution to ask staff to perhaps open a dialogue with the Driftwood into whether constructing an arrangement is possible and cost viable in such a way as... the need for censorship would be removed in terms of trust instructing it.
Do you want to put that in the form of a resolution? And I would presume that simply by asking staff to enter into that conversation with the Driftwood, then staff getting the advice that they need would be included as a package.
Before you start, I mean, let's wrap it into one, that we get staff to have discussions with the Driftwood as to what they can do. And also, I mean, we need to look at what the other options are, also get advice in terms of how we would proceed if we were to continue under the present arrangement.
Two resolutions.
Is it two? Sure, whatever, or we'll do both.
Is your thought in relation to the editing question?
Well, absolutely. I think we should have more than just the Driftwood is an option. There's three options. Yeah. There's the Driftwood option, if we can be made to work. Option number two is to continue what we're doing now, but make sure that we do it in a way that it's going to protect the trust. So we need legal advice on that one. Or three, we stop doing it.
Yeah, and that's good. I agree with that, because if we can't construct an arrangement with the driftwood, we need to somehow put in place a system whereby if we need to censor, we take off a toenail rather than the whole leg. We took off the leg last time, and I think it caused some disquiet.
It was a foot, just a foot.
Yeah, it's not a chiropodist I would use.
Before we get a motion on the floor, can I just ask the planning manager, I've got a little bit of concern about us saying in the resolution the driftwood, because if we're contracting for a service, we're not at least meant to direct it politically. So do you have any advice for us on how we could frame the work that you'd like to do without...
Our local publisher?
I think what I hear you is requesting staff to... explore options, including use of media.
Mm-hmm. Local media.
Including use of local media.
Yeah.
To implement this service.
Yeah.
To implement
the video recording service
in a manner that abrogates the. Trusts need to censor defamatory remarks.
I would just stop at the video service, video recording service. I mean, it's because that's I mean, because that does that. As soon as somebody else is doing it, then it's we have nothing to say about it. We only have something to say if we're paying Peter or somebody to do it.
If it's in
somebody else's hands, then you know anybody can record whatever they like. There's a.
But we pay them.
I think we'd look at several different options.
That's fine.
Contract,
let's keep it simple.
What does it mean? Grant, what does it mean? What are the different?
That's fine.
Yes.
Okay. Peter, would you like
okay,
to read
so,
that?
Okay. Don't say anything. I'm saying we direct staff to be directed to explore options for videotaping, including the use of local media to implement the video recording service, or to continue, not to implement, we've got it going, to continue a video recording service, and to seek legal advice? No, advice? Legal advice? Yeah?
He'll do that
and legal advice as to how to
avoid censorship.
Yeah, advice as to means to into ways to avoid censorship.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's important.
Into ways to avoid censorship.
Okay, so
who can read that back a second time?
I was not being
challenged.
Okay, staff. So I move that staff be directed to explore options for videotaping, including the use of local media, to continue the video recording service, and to seek legal advice as to ways to avoid censorship.
Is there a seconder?
Sorry, seconded.
How's our minute taker doing with that?
I'll read that, what I've got, and you can, because I don't think I've got it exactly. Move the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee direct staff to explore options to videotape, including the use of local media, to continue videotaping.
Video recording, to continue the video recording service.
Options to videotape to, is that not required to include? Continue the video recording service.
And
to seek legal advice regarding ways to avoid censorship.
Yes.
So it directs staff to explore options to videotape?
Or for videotaping we had, but you can say for videotaping.
Including the use of local media to continue the video recording service.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You've tried to save us from
ourselves,
but I think
It's
I think we're just going to have to carry on.
It's all right. It's not pretty, but we know what we mean.
But thank you. It's a good effort. Moved and seconded.
Yeah.
Is there any further discussion? Are you ready to vote? All those in favor? That passes unanimously. I'm just going to flag just a couple things, though we've already made the decision. In response to Trustee Groves' question around what other local governments do, when I was looking about a year and a half ago, most other local governments are not doing town hall sessions or not doing the number of public delegations. So it may be that the alignment of who's videotaping, who's allowing public input, there may not be a lot of overlap.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently our communities are more litigious than others, so we may be once again at the beginning of this interface.
Mm.
And then secondly, when we do go forward, I think that the trust committee is going to have to be really specific, or I hope that the planning staff will encourage us to be more specific, remembering that, you know, we've got the ability to up front to set the terms of service, but then we can't dictate, you know, once the contract's let. So for example, do we want to carry out the recommendations of Peter Prince around what we do next? Do we want to give direction on whether we want it posted on our website, which I think is much more professional and appropriate than having it on YouTube? Do we want it live streaming? Do we want it available faster? Do we need it stored forever? Those kind of considerations.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm hoping that we can get a little bit more specific.
Yeah,
but we don't have to deal with that now.
No, just flagging
good
that.
Good points.
Yes, all of Peter's points to be considered.
Mm-hmm. Then, thanking staff very much and recognizing once again, this is one of these projects we didn't think was a big deal, but it's taken a lot of staff time and it may take half of our budget next year, which is important to remember. Our next item, another contentious
next
topic.
Next item is a 3-minute stretch. You
oh, now we're having a 3-minute stretch.
Well, you said I couldn't have it last time.
By consent, we are recessing momentarily. We are at 15:02 on the agenda. There is no paper, and we're inviting Planner Stefan Cermak to introduce his verbal report on the mapping pilot project.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Do you mind if I stand?
Of course.
Go right ahead.
We prefer to face you. So, thank you. I'm just here to give you an update on the GAR pilot stream mapping. The Island Stream and Salmon Enhancement Society has completed both mapping and a report and has submitted all the deliverables. That included a great amount of data, which is currently mostly in the digital format. You know, boundaries of the watershed were established, raw applicable streams were identified and mapped, barriers were mapped, including waterfalls and culverts, and a map of each watershed was produced. So the maps and written report are being reviewed by staff right now. We're going through making sure it's got everything we need, and unfortunately there may be delay in presenting to the LTC as our GIS coordinator, who takes care of all the digital data, is currently unavailable. So when he returns, he'll be able to really give us the specifics on the data, make sure there's no corruption and stuff like that. And, and the further delay is for the next LTC meeting. Ironically, staff, myself, will be away from the next April 25th staff meeting, LTC meeting on RAR training. So I'll be away for a 2-day course regarding RAR and assessment methods and what have you. So that's really all I came to say about RAR.
So when are you saying we'll have a formal presentation here on the mapping?
I'm saying if I'm involved, it won't be April 25th, it'll be the one after that, which I estimate was about May
15th. So 6 weeks from now then?
That is correct.
Okay.
And in the meantime, there's peer review of that and work at the GIS level?
There's staff review.
Okay.
So yeah, the GIS and myself will be both going over. I've spent a fair amount of time already going over the information, the deliverables, and making sure everything makes sense.
If it's possible, some interim report, even delivered by another staff member in your behalf, while you're away, might be informative, but it depends what there is worth reporting.
Okay, or there's the other option. Part of the deliverables was that the Island Stream Sound Enhancement Society would make a presentation. So I'd rather do a more of a community information style presentation, but if you'd like something like that, I'm sure it could be arranged as well. So if you want to see something at the next meeting, I'm sure something will be arranged, but like I said, I will not be here.
Okay.
Are we happy to leave it in staff hands so far as the right timing when we've got...
Yes.
Part of it does depend on another, the staff member that's expert in GIS mapping, and so we do have some constraints there. Any questions from the trustees on the process?
No, you're at this point, you're happy with what's been done as far as you can tell.
Indeed.
Good.
Yeah.
And when do we pay for the services?
It was a service, and the year ended March 31st, so the... let's say the counting has been dealt with.
I see, okay.
Mm-hmm. But to be clear, I mean, the group was very gung-ho and willing to do. They're just really excited.
Good.
Great, very good.
Great. Thank you very much.
If we can ask, planner Trustee Grove had a question about some of the work around industrial lands on the island.
Yes, you've been doing some work, I think, as a consequence of the John Cornell application looking for at industrial land options, and I'm wondering where you're at on that.
Well, as per the last time I did a presentation, February 23rd, I think it was, at the LTC, I was using the recommendations of the industrial task force plus just the general mapping to sort of help inform that particular application, and I'm not much further than I was at that point, to tell you the truth. It's most of the sort of mapping and ideas were done. The report writing hasn't been done to follow up on it. And that was mainly because of waiting for the trigger of the acoustic report, and then that was going to funnel us all into a report mode, so to speak. So the research hasn't really progressed too much beyond that, other than to make a few minor edits on a map, noting where possible locations could be for that particular application.
Does it have to tie in with the acoustic report? I mean, this is a useful exercise you're undertaking in any event, no matter, you know, quite apart from the John Cornell application. Seems like a very worthwhile exercise.
Well, I'm not sure if we're communicating well on what you think I'm doing with the Industrial Task Force report. What I'm doing is that my primary purpose was, as per recommendation or discussion, is to find suitable locations for that particular operation.
Oh, okay.
So everything else I have done side work out of curiosity. It's very crude, say, for example, the Industrial Task Force recommendations, how far have we progressed on them? It's been a very true just curiosity, how far have we gone, things like that. But I really spent no time, because that's a project unto itself, and I know it's on the project priority list, and it is high, but I haven't been directed to do that, so I've been focusing on the application, not the project.
So it makes sense to tie it in with this application then,
no? No. It makes sense to, for me anyways, to focus on the application. How does it work with the application? But if you want to ask those greater questions about what's happened with the Industrial Task Force report, how much are we pursuing it, that would take a substantially more analysis. I've just done a crude kind of check of, how far have we done that kind of thing, but no analysis associated with just how we have it.
Yeah, I think they are related, and I think it's something we did ask for, that we expressed a view that should run parallel.
Well, the resolution is pretty clear. I have the resolution in here that I've been working under.
My recollection of the conversation was, if what the staff are doing is processing a development application, then we can give direction and they carry on to process it regardless. But if we want a bigger picture proposal or work project that is not specific only to that development application, we need to put it on our work program. And right now we've got four things that are a higher priority than that.
But I think we can achieve what we want through this application, through the Cornell application, because you are searching for alternative sites.
Correct.
Good.
To that one. So that may be the thing, is we need to wait maybe for the staff report on Mr. Quinnell's rezoning application. And when we've got that in hand, then the trust committee will be able to assess whether we need to direct more generic work that's not specific only to his operation.
That makes sense to me.
I'll think on it.
To be clear, though, the work I am doing will definitely is great seed work for that.
Yes.
It is moving forward, it's just that's not the focus.
Good, thank you.
And if we need to give more specific direction, then we can look at that at our next meeting to just make sure it's documented. Thanks very much to the planner. Appreciate your report. We have our next meeting at 16:01 is scheduled for April 26. 16:02 just looks like an error there. Yes, so that's just maybe by consent we can just agree to strike 16:02 from the agenda. It's
agreed.
About last month's item. And I'll ask the trustees whether you've got any closing comments or new business.
I have neither.
To wisdom?
Neither.
Nope.
I had lots of wisdom, but I'll keep them to myself.
No.
All right. Then by consent, we'll adjourn the meeting.
Thank you.
Thanks to the trustees and the planning staff.
Thank you.